stand on your feet. We're going to get into worship here in a second.
Our God, a firm foundation, our rock, the only solid ground, as nations rise and fall, kingdoms once strong now shaken, we trust forever in your name. Name of Jesus. We trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. Sing unmatched.
Unmatched in all your wisdom. Justice you will reign, and every knee will bow. We bring our expectations, our hope is anchored in your name, the name of Jesus. Oh, we trust. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. Victorious, you are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious.
Y'all make some noise this morning. We're We're glad to be here. Would you turn to a neighbor, turn to a friend, just give them a handshake, give them a hug, give somebody, make someone feel encouraged this morning at Outpost. Go ahead and make our way back to our seat. We'll get right back into worship here.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I know, when brokenness and pain is all I know, well, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Yeah. Oh. Shame no longer has a place to hide, and I am not a captive to the lies, and I'm not afraid to leave my past behind, 'cause I won't be shaken, no, I won't be shaken, no, my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. No, no. And this power that can break off every chain, this power that can empty out a grave, and this resurrection power that can save, this power in your name, this power in your name, yeah. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Oh, oh, oh. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Lord, my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
Noise for the Lord this morning. Come on.
All right, you can be seated. That was not good enough, but we'll try again later. Hope that everybody's doing well. Welcome to the Outpost, where we exist and we are disciples who experience God, embrace life in the Holy Spirit, and become more like Jesus, and then we teach others to do the same. Amen. Amen, amen. We're glad that you're out here with us. We're excited to be here. We're excited to have you come and join us in worship this morning, where we come to celebrate. We talk about the three seize, right? Celebrate, connect, and contribute. And every Sunday morning, we are glad and happy to be able to celebrate with you as we worship our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. There we go.
And I have Chris Lasky. This is Brent Gilstrap. We co-pastor here at Outpost Church. If this is your first time worshiping here, we welcome you. We're glad you're here. And we pray you feel God's Holy Spirit as we worship together. I just want to mention, you know, Brent mentioned the Sea of Connect, and we have a lot of different Connect groups that you can jump into this fall. And if you go to outpost129.com, click on Connect Groups, you can scroll through lots of different options, and we'd love for you to really jump in one of those, because it's so easy to fall away and fall out of the routine of being part of the church, and we need to be with each other. To be able to encourage each other, be in the Word together, and just to be able to hold each other accountable as well. So really want you to think about and pray about being in a Connect group this year. And again, just good to be here with you. We're excited, excited to feel the cool weather this morning. Can I get an amen for that? Amen. I knew I could.
Y'all, I'm in that, but not disciples of Jesus Christ. Come on, guys. Come on.
But it is great to be here with you. Let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we love you, and we are just thankful for you. We're thankful for a life that is ours in Jesus Christ. We're thankful for the power of the Holy Spirit, and we just pray, Holy Spirit, fall fresh upon us this morning. Help us to feel the love of God. Help us to have hope this morning. And we, as we're walking through our lives this week, we may have things that have been coming up against us, Lord, and just some difficulties, some things that we're just trying to get through, Lord. But we thank you, Father, that you're with us. We're thankful for the possibilities that are born of faith. We thank you for the reminder of Scripture that you do have good plans for us. And while we might find ourselves in a valley right now, around the corner, you have a mountaintop for us. And so, Lord, wherever we are, though, help us to experience your love, your grace, your mercy, your power. And Lord, we pray that you're glorified by this time together this morning. As we come together for worship, we come to worship you. So God, make yourself known. Give us the hope of faith, and may you be glorified in all things. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Would you stand with us once again? The battle rages, we will stand in a fight. And though the armies rise up against us on all sides, we will not be shaken. We will not be shaken. We will not be shaken. Tremble, we won't be afraid. Hope is rising like the blind. God is stronger. He can do all things.
Amen.
No higher name we can call. Jesus is greater. We can do all things. All those against him will fall. Our God is stronger. He can do all things. Oh, there's no higher name we can call. For Jesus is greater. We can do all things. Yes, for we trust in our shaken. We will not be shaken.
We're united in you. We're so happy to be yours, God. Through you we have unfailing love, we have trust, we have solid ground, and in the valley we have a light. We have a shining beacon. We have something to walk toward. In our darkest day, in the hour of our darkest day, we have you. We have the light that breaks up the darkness. We don't have to tremble. We don't have to shake. We don't have to be afraid, because we have you to hold on to. We have your promise. We have your son. We have your sacrifice. We have your grace, and we're so thankful. We just pray this message reaches us this morning in a way that is distinctly divine, the way that you would have us receive it this morning. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Y'all can take a seat.
As we begin our time of getting into the Word and the message, we are continuing our worship series entitled Holy Cow. Holy cow, it's challenging to be a Christian in today's world. Holy cow, it's hard to live a godly life in the midst of an ungodly culture. And so we're really just diving into 1 Peter and seeing what he has to say to us about what it means to live a holy life, or how it is we can possibly strive for holiness in today's world. And kind of our main definition of holiness is that ability to love one another deeply from the heart. To love one another deeply from the heart. And we know we can't do that successfully by ourselves without God's help and without God's grace. And we've looked at holiness within our individual lives, within the community, within relationships. And today, again, we're really just trying to extract some help from God's Word on how to love others deeply from the heart. And we know, and we've talked about the fact that holiness, it's not something that happens externally, it's something that happens internally. And then when God gets that holiness inside of us, then we begin to act differently externally. And we begin to talk differently. We begin to live our lives differently. And so it shows up on the outside, even to the extent where people notice. They notice the different behaviors that we have versus what the world has, and we're called to be different. We're supposed to be different than the world. And so, but as we look at this whole idea of holiness, today we're really just want to talk more about the fact that sin management is not holiness. Trying to manage sin on our own power, it doesn't work. But it's our holiness that is to help us from sin really having a foothold in our lives. And so, but we know, right, even though we're believers, sin remains, but it no longer reigns, right? Mm-hmm. The sin remains, but it no longer reigns. And so when it comes to overcoming our sins, how does our holiness really help us to do that? You know, because we still do things and we say things and we watch things that we know we shouldn't. And then as soon as we do that, we feel the guilt and shame that comes up from it. And then we don't do things that we know we should do. And so again, how does our faith really impact our sin lives? And how does it help us to overcome our sins? Are you with me? Anybody? Anybody? All right. Kind of with us. Come on, Brent. Fire them up. All right. So we're going to be in 1 Peter 4. So go ahead and open up your Bibles. Turn to 1 Peter 4. And we do just recommend, this is like your best friend. So definitely bring it with you on Sunday mornings. It says, therefore, since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourselves with the same attitude. Because whoever suffers in the body is done with sin. And as a result, they do not live the rest of their earthly lives for evil human desires, but rather for the will of God. For you have spent enough time in the past doing what pagans choose to do, living in debauchery, lust, drunkenness, orgies, carousing, and detestable idolatry. They are surprised that you do not join them in their reckless, wild living. And they heap abuse on you. But they will have to give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. For this is the reason the gospel was preached even to those who are now dead, so that they might be judged according to human standards in regards to the body, but live according to God in regard to the spirits.
Amen. And as you read those verses, how many of you like followed along and reading those verses and you like, get to the end and you're like, I have no idea what Peter is talking about. Anybody in that boat? Some of you shaking your head. It's okay to admit it, right? So we read those words and we're like, what in the world is Peter talking about? And one of the things that he's given an imagery of is dying with Christ and being raised with him and what that looks like and how we're supposed to feel about that and how we're supposed to act, how that is going to change us from the inside out. And we keep talking week after week that holiness, again, is not something that happens on the outside to change us on the inside, but it's something that happens on the inside, and because of that change, then we act differently on the outside. And it reminded me of Galatians 2:20. So we have that verse, right? Galatians 2:20. There we go. And it says, I've been crucified with Christ and no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. So this whole idea of being crucified with Christ in the flesh and being dead to our sins, and it's that imagery of baptism, right? When we take our baptismal vows and we get in the water and we say that we're dead to our sins as we go under the water, and then when we get raised up, that we're raised up through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and we get to participate in that act with him. And when we think about being crucified in our flesh, what we're really talking about is being dead to our sins, right? Being dead to our sins. And as Chris said, it's sin remains because how many of us, You don't have to raise your hand. Sin every day. Well, you can raise your hand if you want to. We all sin, right? Everybody. We know that sin remains, but it's no longer ruler of our life. When we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, as Lord and leader of our life, then we strive to act differently. We strive to do things differently because of that change that happens on the inside. It's that instantaneous change. It's my Shazam shirt, right? It's the change in an instant that we're created a new creation. We're totally different because we accepted Christ as our personal Lord and Savior in that moment. So when we experience that change, then it requires a new way of life, a new way of living, and we call that striving in holiness. Or another term that's used throughout the Bible is discipleship, right? We follow Jesus and we become more and more like Him. I love the imagery in Luke chapter 9, verse 23, where it talks about taking up our cross daily and following Him, right? So we know that Jesus made the decision to come down to this earth, to die for our sins, to live a life and be persecuted and rejected. He made that decision. And so for us as followers of Christ, we make a decision to take up our cross daily and follow Him. And when we take up our cross, that requires death. That requires death. And that's death to our desires, death to our sin, death to the things that we no longer should do because we are living with Christ. And we see here in 1 Peter chapter 4, can you put up verse 3 for me, Adam? 1 Peter chapter 4, there's this list of stuff, right? There's this list of stuff that seems like an extreme example, right? Yep, keep going, one more. There we go. Living in debauchery, lust, drunkenness, orgies, carousing, and detestable idolatry. So when we read that verse, we're like, wow, right? Wow, that seems very extreme, Peter. Why did you use those examples as the list of sin? But we think about it, when you think about what's going on here in 2019, does sin look any different than this? No. It's still the same sin. It's still the same sin. And what we're living with and among is the same stuff. It's the same stuff. So as a follower of Christ, what Peter is saying is like, you know, you used to live that way. And now people should see a difference in you. You should no longer live that way. You should no longer live in those things. Not that you won't sin, but you're striving to be something different and do something different. I was watching a show this past week, Finger of God 2. Some of you are familiar with it and some of you may not be. But in Finger of God 2, there's this one scene in this one kind of episode where they're going through. And Brian Head Welch, does anybody know who Brian Head Welch is? He was the lead guitarist of the heavy metal rock band Korn. Any Korn fans out there? You can ask for forgiveness later, but that's okay. All right.
There's one in the back.
But Korn was this heavy metal hard rock band in the 90s, and it was some extreme music. And Brian Head Welch was the lead guitarist in that group. And he lived the life, right? The life of a rock and roll star. He drugs, debauchery, all of those things that we just saw in that one slide, right? He lived a life like that. And he got to a point where his ex-wife had died and because of drug use, and he was in all of this stuff. And he was on the bathroom floor after he had been wasted. And he's like, I can't live like this anymore. I can't live like this. He said, God, I don't know if you're out there, but if you're there and you're real, I'm going to give my life to you, but you're going to have to make me different. And from that moment on, that Shazam change happened in his life. And in this scene in Finger of God 2, he's actually going into bars and places in Ireland. And he's, you know, just, they know who he is because it's that kind of atmosphere. They know who Korn is. And he's using it to give his testimony and to give a witness about Jesus Christ, right? No longer is he living that rock and roll lifestyle. He's still in the band and they're still doing tours and stuff, but he's living a different life. There's a noticeable, a detectable difference in his life before Christ and now his life after Christ. And the same goes true for us. Like, if we're still living in those same things, if there's really no difference in our lives pre-Christ versus post-Christ, we have to be honest with ourselves and ask ourselves, have we really been changed? Are we really saved? And I know that that's something like you wouldn't imagine in church with people gathering, but I think it's an honest question that we must ask in all of our churches. If there is no difference in our life pre- and post-Christ, then are we really saved? Have we really given everything over to him? And that's what Peter is saying. Like, there should be a difference. All this list of stuff, you shouldn't be doing that anymore. You should be living, as he says in verse 3, after the Spirit of God and how the Spirit of God does. So how do we begin to do that? Well, I think that Peter begins to give us some advice in verse 7 through 11. He says, "The end of all things is near. Therefore, be alert and of sober mind so that you may pray. Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers over a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. If anyone serves, they should do so with the strength God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory." So that first verse, verse 7, it says, "The end of all things are near." And I think that that's something lost on today's church in America in 2019, right? Like, we kind of exist as though the world is never going to end. We don't have that sense of urgency that Christ could come back anytime. We don't have that sense of urgency that our lives could be over with in a blink of an eye. And we all have heard stories just this past week, right, of people's lives being ended very suddenly and very shortly. But yet we continue to live as though it doesn't matter. And if the time is now, there's no time to waste. And I like how the NRSV version puts verse 7. It says, "The end of all things is near. Therefore, be serious and discipline yourselves for the sake of your prayers." Be serious. It's something to take note of. Discipline yourselves. There is work to be done for the sake of your prayers. And as we talked about last week in chapter 3, and we talked about how our earthly decisions, the things that we do here on this earth, can affect our spiritual lives. And we use the example that Paul uses in 1 Peter 3, where the way that a husband treats his wife can affect his prayers. Well, the same thing goes for everyone, right? We discipline ourselves for the sake of our prayers, because our level of devotion and consecration to the Lord affects our prayers. It affects our prayers. I'm reminded of the parable of the talents that Jesus used, right? He said, to one was given one, to one was given five, and to the other was given 10. So the Lord distributes responsibility. And we know that through Christ, grace and forgiveness is free. Grace and forgiveness is free, but trust is earned. And so as we're devoted to Christ and we consecrate ourselves and we try to use our gifts and do the things that Christ wants us to do, then he gives us more and more responsibility. And I don't know about you, but I get excited. I get jacked up about being a tool, an instrument of Jesus Christ. And it also saddens me, because I know that if I don't steward that well and if I don't do the things that Christ wants me to do, that his will is going to be done no matter what. Amen? But however, if I choose not to be used, then he's going to pass me over and use somebody else. That brings me deep sadness to know that if I don't do the will of Christ, then he's going to get his will done, but he's just going to use somebody else. I want to be used. I want to be used as a tool and instrument of the Lord. So our devotion, our dedication, our discipline affects those things. And he says it in verse 10, Peter, using your gift, God's gifts, the gifts of the Holy Spirit, the gifts that the Lord has given you for the furtherance of his kingdom. And he also goes on to say, if you speak, speak as words coming out of God's mouth. You are God's mouthpiece. Chris says it all the time. The church, all of us as followers of Christ, are Jesus' plan A. There is no plan B. So when we go out into the world, whether into our job places, into the schools, or restaurants, wherever we may be, we need to speak as God's speaking. We need to get rid of gossip and slander and put downs and all of those things, because we are God's mouthpiece and we need to be used as such. Our holiness, the lives that we live now, should be different than the world, and it should be different than our past life before Jesus Christ. Yeah.
And as we think about... As Brent mentioned early on about being crucified with Christ and being raised with Christ. I think really that is what he's done for us really is at the heart of holiness. To be people who don't take that lightly, to be people who just really appreciate his sacrifice and really cooperate with what he has done for us. And even the first verse where it says, therefore, since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourself also with the same attitude, because whoever suffers in the body is done with sin. And that really is kind of pointing back to the fact that Jesus died for us, that he was crucified for us. And so often we can say those phrases, crucified with Christ, resurrected with Christ, and just forget about the fact that Jesus didn't die peacefully on his bed surrounded by his loved ones. Jesus' death was a gruesome and horrible death. And he endured things physically in his body that I think about just if even one of the little things that happened to him in his flesh happened to us, like we'd be in the hospital for a month or two, and it's excruciating. Even with the whip with which he was whipped has the cattails, the little metal barbs that are designed to actually rip off flesh. And that's just this little tiny part of what Jesus endured for us. And nails, we know nails were placed in his hands or in his wrists, in his legs. Nails driven into his flesh. And then ultimately, his blood was literally poured out for us. And so as we think about, how he died for our sin, and we don't have to physically die like that. He's already done it, right? But we have to recognize that sacrifice and that grace that then now covers our sins, that's a costly grace. Amen. It is so costly. And I think sometimes as we think about that we are crucified with Christ, I think it means in some ways like we can't be flippant about his sacrifice. We can't overlook it. We have to really engage with it and recognize the extent of sacrifice that he went through. And I know if you've ever seen movies like Passion of the Christ, like you really get a good idea of what he endured for us. And some people are like, oh, I can't watch that. It's too gruesome. Or I don't like to think about that. Well, we need to think about that. Yeah. We need to be thinking about that, like all the time. That's what it means to be crucified with him is to never forget or take for granted what he's done for us. And so I think about that again, like it was so costly. And often we think about the fact that, he didn't have to stay on the cross. He could have gotten down in a second. You know, but people will say, but love for you is what kept him on the cross. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking about how, you know, we hear about that final breath that he has and how he gave his spirit up to the Father. You know, in that final breath out, what if he was saying your name? You know, in that final breath, it's like a breath prayer of like saying your actual name. And so, yeah, we've been crucified with him, but it was costly. And then we think about how we're resurrected with him. You know, he overcame death because the Holy Spirit raised him up.
Amen.
And the Holy Spirit gave him that new breath. And as we talk about how we have been raised with Christ, it's really that we have that Spirit in us. Any of this stuff when it comes to sin, we can't get over it on our own power. We have to have the power of God in us to overcome our sins. And so again, we can't take that for granted. You know, it's Jesus' power that enables us to overcome our sin. It's grace. It's God's grace. And again, it's a costly grace. And I think about, you know, have you ever been like sick for a real long time that by the time you get well, like you forget you actually what it was like to feel good? Like, wow, like I feel fantastic. I picture that's how Jesus felt times 100 as he came out of the tomb, filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. And when we participate in that resurrection, we should walk with a little extra bounce in our steps because we have the power of the risen Lord inside of us. And so, again, as we share in his suffering and in his resurrection, we also share in his resurrection. And so as we think about, again, all those examples in the third verse, James 1, 14 and 15 is a verse that really helps us to see that sin doesn't usually happen in just a moment. It's usually, there's a kind of a process to it. James 1, 14 says, but each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. And then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it's full grown, gives birth to death. And so I'm a process kind of guy. I think analytically. So we have that desire springing up. We have temptation. We have sin. And we have death. And by the time you get to, you've sinned and you have the death, it's kind of too late to do anything about it, right? And when you're in the midst of sin, it's a little bit too late. But what about the beginning? When you begin to feel that desire well up, and you begin to be tempted, that is really the moments when sin can still be overcome. It's not too late. And so neuroscientists tell us that we have about 5 seconds for the brain to make a decision. And so we talk about slaying sin. That's our sermon title this morning. For sin to be slain, it has to happen in the first 5 seconds. After that amount of time, it's already too late. And so as we think about that, you know, we think about lust, we think about gluttony, we think about anger. There's this period of time where you feel those things begin to kind of rise up, right? And so again, it's really that time that the Holy Spirit can help you shut those things down. And again, that word slain. The Holy Spirit enables you to say no to those things. Again, in our own power, we're doomed. But Jesus' power, the power of the Holy Spirit, can help us shut down sin in those first few seconds. One example, Netflix, right? Great. A lot of us have gotten rid of cable because we have Netflix. Amen. Which has been great. A little cost-saving tip there for you. You really don't need cable. So when, you know, when you're watching a show, and Brent and I talk about this a lot, like when we're watching a show and certain things come on the screen, we know we got to shut it off, right? There are a lot of inappropriate things on shows in Netflix. And if you don't turn it off and you let yourself watch the things you shouldn't watch, then those images are what gets stuck in your brain, right? Those images, they can continue to come up in your thoughts and kind of, you know, reign over your mental capacities. But if you're watching a show and you begin to know, like, you know where it's going, when it begins to unfold in such a way, in those first few seconds is when you need the Holy Spirit to tell you, and He'll tell you, but then you have to cooperate with what the Spirit's saying. You have to actually shut it off, right? That's really the thing. It's the Holy Spirit's power in those first few seconds of a decision that we need to shut it down. And really, as you look at sin across the board, that idea works for everything. And if you're struggling with whether or not to have a drink, you've got a little time frame there to say no if alcohol is one of those things that you know gets you in trouble.
Anger.
Yeah. What about anger? Can you feel it coming up, don't you? You know it's coming. And for your sake and your family's sake, let the Holy Spirit shut that down. Pornography is a huge issue in the world today, but statistics show it's just about the same in the life of the church. And so when you're putting in certain words into a browser to be able to search something, it takes about 5 seconds. So in those 5 seconds, again, let the Holy Spirit shut that down. Not on your own power. What about eating that sixth cupcake? You know, my wife is the best baker.
So we gotta wait till the sixth one?
Oh, wait. I guess it doesn't make sense. The fifth one.
The fifth one.
No. No, it's the same. It's the same thing with gluttony, right? When you have that time to make the decision, and also with impulse buys. You know, my wife and I, we don't even go into stores much anymore. Because when you go into stores, the impulse buying is easy to do. But again, make that decision within the first 5 seconds.
Amen.
And so, and I think too, when it comes to our thought lives, just in general, if you begin to have negative thoughts or impure thoughts or doubts or negative thoughts about yourself, to shut that down, you know, get a mental sword out, the sword of the Word, the sword of the Spirit, and to be able to just to slice through those sins, that those desires, those temptations as they begin to come up.
Yeah, amen. So when I think about the 5 second rule, it's not when food drops on the floor and I can eat it within 5 seconds.
No,
that's not the same
it's
thing.
It's not the same thing.
All right, not the same thing.
You can go ahead and eat the food if it's been 5 seconds.
Oh, okay, 5 seconds. All right. but I think it's good advice in a lot of ways. Like, we have a window of opportunity to make a decision. And again, that decision comes from the internal change that we've already experienced through Christ Jesus. Yeah. It's not like we're just trying to do better. It's that we know, as remembering what Christ suffered and the cost of His grace, that we should do better, right?
Yeah.
And so I think that as we're wrapping up this morning, and we want to ask ourselves a few questions. And the first question needs to be, does our life look differently now than it did pre-Jesus? And if it doesn't, then we need to be honest with ourselves and ask ourselves, have we really been changed? And if we haven't, today is the day. Today is the opportunity to accept Jesus Christ as our Lord, leader of our life, and the Savior and Messiah over our life. And then we know at that point, sin remains but no longer reigns. And then the second part of it, I think, becomes we all have areas in our life that where we need to do better at slaying sin, where we need to do better at asking ourselves within those first 5 seconds, is this what I need to be looking at? Is this what I need to be doing? Is this what I need to be reacting to. And if we haven't, if we have areas in our lives that we haven't fully surrendered and laid down at the foot of the cross and taken up the cross, then we need to concentrate on those areas and allow the Lord, the Holy Spirit, to convict, to convince, and to help us change. So as we pray this morning, I want you just to search your mind, search your heart, search your body, search your soul. Just ask yourself, Holy Spirit, what are you speaking to me this morning? How can I slay sin? How can I be changed? Let us pray. Most gracious God, we just thank you this morning for Jesus, first of all, for your sacrifice, for your willingness to become like a man, to become a man, to live on this earth, to endure all the things that we've endured, pain, suffering, rejection, to go to that cross, to bear the weight of my sin, to bear the weight of the sin of every person in this building this morning, to bear the weight of the sin of the world on that cross. Not for any other reason, but because you loved us. Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you for your sacrifice. But Lord, glory to you, we thank you for your resurrection. Yes, Lord. That even being dead wasn't enough. That the power of your Holy Spirit, the resurrection power, lifted you up and exalted you, Lord. And we thank you for that this morning. I would pray for any person in this room this morning that has searched their heart and searched their soul, and maybe they're found lacking this morning. They've never accepted you truthfully and honestly as Lord and leader of their life. And Lord, they're yearning for that change. They want to be changed from the inside out. They're tired of struggling with sin and it's reigning over their life. Yes. If that's you this morning, I would just ask you to pray this simple prayer after me. Jesus, I'm sorry. Jesus, I've failed. Jesus, I believe that you went to the cross and died for my sins. Jesus, I trust you as Lord, leader, Savior, and Messiah of my life. Jesus, I choose to follow you. Thank you. If that's you this morning, if that's the first time that you've ever honestly prayed that prayer and meant it, I'd ask you to raise your hand as a sign of a changed life this morning. Thank you. And Jesus, I pray for everyone else in this room that has made that decision to follow you, whether it's been recently or years earlier, that we would search our minds, our bodies, and our souls, search our lives for areas that we've not fully surrendered to you. Areas where we struggle to slay sin. And Lord, I pray through the power of the Holy Spirit, through the resurrection power, that we would give those up to you. And you would help us overcome. Lord Jesus, we know through your death and resurrection, we are overcomers. We can overcome sin. Sin no longer reigns. It no longer has rule over our life. It is slayed. Lord, we just thank you. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you. We thank you and we love you. And we just ask that you continue just to guide us and direct us as we seek to follow you, as we seek to change our lives, as we seek to look differently from the world. We need your help.
Yes, God.
Help us, Jesus. Lord, we ask all these things in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
amen. 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 At this time, we're going to move into our response time. And one of our response options to the word is to take part in Holy Communion. And Holy Communion is a sacrament of the church. And we talk about it's a means of grace. So it's one of the ways that God's grace gets in us that then enables us to live a life of holiness. And so we can't over talk about the significance of the table enough. It's so important to our lives of faith. And really, you know, as we talk about being ones who remember what Jesus has done for us, I think sometimes when we first come to the Lord or we're filled with the Holy Spirit, we have a season where it's like sin is so far from us, but then over time, it begins to become closer and closer. And so if we're going to continue to cooperate and to recognize the crucifixion, we have to be in our Bibles. We have to be in prayer. We have to be with each other in ways that we can connect. It's how we keep his what he's done for us, the fact that Jesus was slain. That's how we keep it at the forefront of our minds. And so this response time is, again, just another time to respond to God's grace, to the Word of God, to come to the table. These boxes up here that say Outpost, those are our also our offering boxes. So if you'd like to sow into the work that God's doing and respond to his grace and love, we can give here. Put in your connect cards here, and also come up for prayer if you just want somebody to come and pray with you about, you know, whatever you might be going through. We invite you to do so.
Amen. And we know on the night before Jesus was crucified, he took the bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take and eat, for this is my body broken for you. And oft as you do so in remembrance of me." And then after the meal, he took the cup and he lifted it high to heaven and he blessed it and he said, "This is the blood, my blood, that is shed for you and for many. Take and drink, and as often as you do so in remembrance of me." So Holy Spirit, we just beseech you now to pour out your grace upon these meager gifts of bread and juice and make them for us the body and blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. The table is always open to anyone. So we would invite you now to respond as ever how you see fit. So please come.
If you're not standing, would you stand back up with us, please, and let's jump back into worship here. When I was down, you brought me out. You set my feet on hollow ground. So here I stand. You are my God. Your faithfulness, my solid rock. Yeah, I give thanks for all you have done. I will sing of your mercy and your love. Love is unfailing. Lord, I am grateful. I give thanks for all you have done. I won't forget all the battles you have won. Love is unfailing. Lord, I am grateful. Y'all make some noise for the Lord again this morning. God, thank you so much for everything you do in our lives. We are grateful. We're so loved and we're treasured. And we get to lift our hands and praise you. You open the heavens up for us. You send your Son. That sacrifice. Just such a powerful example that you set, that you would come down and take our form and pay for our sins. We pray that this week as we go out, we take those 5 seconds to hear your voice. We take those 5 seconds to listen for the Holy Spirit, and instead of acting on instinct or acting on anger or on lust or on whatever it may be, we pray that we hear your discerning voice in our lives. We take those, it's just a few seconds before we make split-second decisions instead. We pray that you would keep us Keep us honest this week as we take that charge and move forward with that endeavor. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Y'all have a great Sunday. We hope to see you next week.